Voters who don't turn out when they're wanted, Russians who do turn out when they're not wanted. Two subjects we'll be discussing in Manchester tonight. Good evening and welcome to Question Time from Manchester. Our panel tonight, Gerald Kaufman, Chairman of the House of Commons Culture, Media and Sport Select Committee, Theresa May, who came into the Shadow Cabinet at Education and Employment this week, only 2 years after coming into the House of Commons, Don Foster, one of the front runners for the Liberal Democratic leadership, Sheila McKechnie, Director of the Consumers Association, and Charlie Whelan, the former advisor to Gordon Brown, who was forced out in the wake of Peter Mandelson's resignation. And before I take the first question, my apologies to those of you who thought we might have a different panel tonight, but because of the Euro elections, we made some changes. I hope the people we previously asked for tonight will come at a later date. Now let's get straight on to our first question, which is from Stephanie Bland, who is a housewife.
Does the panel feel that the very low turnout rate for the European elections reflects the fact that the public is quite satisfied with the status quo?
The low turnout for the European elections means the public is satisfied with the status quo. Don Foster.
Frankly, I haven't the foggiest notion. It was one of the most appalling turnouts we've had. It was the lowest turnout for any parliamentary election in this country for very many years. It was a very disappointing turnout. And one of the reasons I would argue why that happened was that the political parties did not engage the public in the vitally important debate that should have taken place about the importance of our membership in Europe and, of course, the big issue of our membership of the single currency. The main criticism I would lay at the door, frankly, of the Prime Minister. I understand entirely that he was obviously somewhat preoccupied with what was going on in Kosovo. That is understandable, but really he didn't grab this particular issue by the scruff of the neck. Frankly, the Liberal Democrats felt a bit like the RAF during the Battle of Britain, desperately knowing we might win that little skirmish, but needing the bigger troops of the Labour Party to come in and help fight the battle, get over the message, the positive message about Europe, and they were found wanting and didn't turn up. A major, major lack of leadership from the Prime Minister.
Charlie Whelan, do you agree with that?
Well, blaming all on the Prime Minister seems a bit ridiculous to me. I mean, there's obviously a number of reasons why people didn't bother to vote. I mean, I come from Peckham in South London, and I noticed the Times newspaper stood outside my polling station, actually, and I think it was something like 12% turnout, and they said, Peckham man doesn't give a stuff about Europe. And I think there is a lot to that as well. I mean, there was a war on. I think a lot of people weren't aware there was an election on. I mean, Labour did try and pull stunts like they got Alex Ferguson, the Manchester United manager, to promote. I know that didn't bring any votes, but at least they were trying to promote the election. But I don't think you can put all the blame on the Prime Minister. I mean, really, that is a bit rum.
Stephanie Bland, do you think it's because people were contented with the status quo? That was one of the theories put about on election night.
I think it is that people are contented. Inflation's down, the unemployment rate is down, and I think people are satisfied with the lot at the moment.
Do you agree with that, Theresa?
I actually find this argument a little strange. I mean, it's a bit like somebody who manufactures cars saying, nobody's buying our cars because they like them so much. And certainly it was the government.
But nothing was for sale, was it?
This idea from the government that because everybody's happy with them, they're not going to go out and vote for their members of the European Parliament. I think there were a variety of reasons why people didn't go out and vote. I think one of the reasons was the fact that it was a proportional representation system. And certainly I found people saying to me that they were unhappy about the fact they couldn't vote for a particular candidate and had to vote for a party. And I think that there wasn't an awful lot, despite the leaflet that came through, there wasn't actually an awful lot done to explain that electoral system to people. I happen not to support that sort of electoral system. I believe in actually being able to vote for a candidate who is then going to represent you. And certainly I found that a lot of people were concerned about not having a candidate they could vote for. But I think also the two other parties ran, well, they didn't really run campaigns at all for the European election. I think we were the only party that actually went out with a clear message to people that was based on issues relating to Europe. That is, that we wanted to be in Europe, not run by Europe. And I think the results of the European elections overwhelmingly showed that actually that was the opinion of the mainstream of British
public. Well, hang on, not overwhelmingly anything. Underwhelming. You got just over 8% of the total electorate voted. Right. You can't call that an overwhelming endorsement.
More people, more of those who actually went out and voted, Conservative than voted anything else.
The woman in yellow here.
I think most people didn't. Not only did they not understand what it was all about, but there was no representation, there was no house-to-house visiting. Elderly people weren't contacted at all. Just a little bit of paper through the door is supposed to explain the whole new electoral system to somebody. They didn't know. And that when you speak to them, their attitude is, what's the point?
Did you vote?
I certainly did.
You did?
Their attitude is, what's the point? We can't change anything. Why vote?
Man at the back there.
Isn't it true that until real power is given to the European Parliament and corruption is outed, that the turnout will not increase?
Because what? People
are disillusionment. People don't believe in the European Parliament because it has no real power. They don't see how their vote affects anything.
Sheila McKechnie, do you agree with that?
No, I don't think that's true, but I think we are failed constantly by both our MEPs and our national party in terms of explaining to us what is important about Europe. I spend a great deal of time in Europe because most of the legislation that affects your everyday life nowadays is coming through Europe in one form or another. Safety regulations, food regulation, you know, all the mundane things of life. And I think it's really unfortunate because I think it actually, the relationship that this country has with Europe is so different from the European countries. There are issues there that are discussed in their elections. I think this was a tragedy for democracy, and I think the political parties are going to have to start discussing Europe in a sensible, straightforward and more honest way. What are the issues? And I think this election, if anything, was just about the minority who came out and voted against the euro.
Okay. The woman in white there, yes.
Isn't one of the main problems to do with the low turnout the fact that the voting system has not gone along with how society has changed? For instance, people's business practices have changed, and it's very difficult, for instance, if you're called away on business like that, you can't arrange a vote, and therefore you're stuck, or you happen to be away on a conference for a week, and you want to vote, and you can't get to your polling station. Isn't that the responsibility of politicians generally, to bring the voting system up to date and to use technology?
Did you vote?
Yes, I did, because I happened to be in my home at that time in the morning. But I know people, for instance, who were mobile during the day for their work and they could not vote.
Okay. The woman in the D&G T-shirt at the back there.
Hi. I think the point about proportional representation that you made, how that has an effect on the voters, I don't really agree with that because we're getting consistently low turnouts, even in the first past the post-elections. So how can you blame it all on proportional representation?
But Gerald Kaufman, this one almost sank without trace, didn't it, compared with any election we've ever had in our history?
It did indeed, and I think that there were a number of reasons. I think that, first of all, not so much the system, but the enormous size of constituencies with up to 5 million voters meant that parties couldn't campaign in a systematic way. That was one problem.
So the wrong system was chosen?
I'm sure the wrong system was chosen, though. As an obedient Labour Member of Parliament, I voted for it.
why did you stick to your vow of obedience?
Because I was elected to Parliament to do as I was told by my constituency, by my constituents, if possible, and by my party, if my constituents hadn't signified an opinion, as they certainly didn't in this election. I think another reason is that people felt it didn't count. Nothing was going to be changed. Nothing is changed by the European Parliament elections in the way that a parliamentary election for Westminster does.
But the Conservative voters must have thought something would change because a lot of them did vote.
Not all that many.
More of them than voted Liberal Democrat.
I was going to say not all that many, but not even more not all that many voted Labour. But I think that the other thing is quite simply this. This country is simply having too many elections. people will vote in a general election, they may vote in a local election. In this, they'd had too many elections in too short a time. And one answer is we should have fewer elections.
Which ones would you abolish?
All except the one every 5 years that re-elects Tony Blair as Prime Minister.
So, you're against devolution?
Oh, no, no, that's for Scots and Welsh. They've got to sort that out for themselves.
Well, they'll have to vote as well.
Every 4 or 5 years.
All local elections you abolish?
I think that there's a great argument for having triennial elections for local authorities in which you elect the whole of the local
authority. Instead of every year?
What about another referendum on electoral system then, Gerald?
Oh, I think we ought to have a referendum on whether there should be a referendum.
Okay, the man in the front row here. Okay.
Belgium had 4 elections on the same day. Why couldn't we have done the same?
Just have all the elections together?
Yeah.
You, sir?
Yes, I object to voting in blocks of 10. If you've been allowed to vote for any candidate out of the block, I mean, you pick 10 people, and the party picks them and picks the order they stand. Now, why should we vote for a block of 10? I would probably have voted one for Green, one for Liberal Democrat, I know quite well. If Gerald had been standing, I'd have voted for him. Yeah. We haven't got enough characters in Parliament, and we certainly haven't got enough characters in Europe.
Okay. And you're only allowed to choose the party anyway. You, sir? The man in the white shirt.
Isn't the truth of the matter is the reason people didn't vote is because there's a serious lack of education about the effects of joining Europe and the European single currency. Mm. And the reason for that is because neither of the parties, even though Theresa May seems to suggest they do, is that neither parties are prepared to put their policy on the line. They keep avoiding the issue, and therefore the media or any other form cannot really tell us about what's going to happen when we do join the European single currency or anything else concerning Europe.
Okay, well, let's just go into that a moment. Stuart Grant is a bank clerk with a question on that very point.
Can Tony Blair now afford to gamble his own political reputation by backing a yes vote in a single currency referendum?
And what do you think?
I think it would be a big gamble for him given the turnout last week.
Charlie Whelan?
Well, I think the Labour's policy on the euro is the right one. I would say that, wouldn't I? I was famously heard briefing it in the Red Lion pub down my mobile phone. But the reason why it's the right one is because this is an economic decision for our country, and I don't think that you can say we're going to rule it out for 10 years. That would be totally irresponsible. And I don't think we could win a referendum on this issue tomorrow. No, we certainly couldn't, because the argument hasn't yet been put. But certainly I think the result of the election, where the Tories did, let's face it, they won. There's no spinning out of that one. The Labour policy is in difficulty. But if the Labour Party fights for its policy, and if Tony Blair fights for it, I'm convinced that if it's the right thing to do for the economy of this country, then we would win a referendum.
But you wouldn't presumably hold a referendum until you thought you could win it,
and you wouldn't
hold a referendum unless you were going in. So,
no,
I mean, the calls
no.
for referendums but I don't, now, I don't make...
I mean, if you look at...
I want to bring back the young man there who spoke about this. Does that satisfy you in terms of the Labour Party's position? Or do you think it's still wishy-washy?
I think if you watch Prime Minister's Question Time this week, he was asked, what are your policies on Europe? What do you stand for? And again he avoided it. And the same with the Tory party. I mean, if you look at their view on the European single currency, one minute they don't want to be in it for 10 years, the next minute they don't want to be in it at all. Why can't you just say clearly and precisely exactly what you want in Europe, and then the general public can make their own decision based on that and based on what effect those policies will have in Europe?
Theresa May?
It was very noticeable, you're absolutely right, in Prime Minister's Questions this week, that Tony Blair was pressed on two issues, one on proportional representation and the other on the euro, and refused to give a clear answer on either of those questions. Refused to say about the referendum on proportional representation and refused to give a clear view on the euro. The problem he has is that, of course, at the time of the general election in 1997, he told readers of The Sun that he loved the pound. And yet what he's done since is said that he wants to scrap the pound.
But
he's giving two different views.
But he also mocked you and William Hague for having what appeared to be a policy of principle that only lasted 8 years.
We had a clear policy, which is that we rule out entry into the single currency this Parliament and for the next Parliament.
Why is that?
And ask any...
I've never understood why.
Never understood why we're ruling it out for this period of time.
Why is it going to be all right after 8 years?
Why?
We are ruling it out for
What's
this period of time.
What's magic about that?
Well, if you wait a minute, Gerald,
I'll tell you the answer.
Yes. We're ruling it out for that period of time because we believe that it's actually necessary to see how the euro is operating in good times and in bad to judge what the impact of the euro is actually going to be. And if you actually look at political parties setting their policies for the future, you will see that parties only ever set their policies for the next parliament. So we will, that is the period over which we set this particular policy. And it's a period of time over which it will be possible to see if how the euro is operating among the 11 member states who've joined it,
yeah.
And whether it is working or whether in good times and in bad.
So if before the 8 years is up, there was a referendum called by a Labour government, the whole Tory party would be whipped to vote no.
The indications have been so far that, in fact, those on the in the Tory party would be able to take their views on this particular
free vote.
Issue.
Free vote.
The comments that were made.
You're a member of the Shadow Cabinet.
Politicians don't like saying yes.
Do you want to expand on this answer?
It was certainly yes. It certainly was said at an earlier stage that people would be able to express their views on this
before they started kicking people out of the party.
The party policy is very clear, and the party policy, which is decided not by the shadow cabinet and the leader, but actually decided by a vote of all the members of the Conservative Party, and an overwhelming majority of the members of the Conservative Party said that they agreed with this policy of not entering the single currency this Parliament or the following Parliament. In contrast, of course, with the Labour Party, where the policies are just determined by Tony Blair and no party members are able to have a say.
Okay. John Foster, Liberal Democrats say they want a referendum as soon as possible, but even the Prime Minister says if there was a referendum now, it would be lost. So why are you so keen to lose a referendum on this?
Well, I'm not keen to lose a referendum. I confess I've been more confused just now about what the Tory position is than I've been for a long time. And I genuinely don't understand a political party that says that they will categorically rule something out for this rather long period of time, even if in the intervening period of time there is very clear evidence that it would be in the interests of this country to do so. I genuinely believe that the case for the euro can be made very clearly and can be won. And I look back to when we had the debate about our entry into Europe, and at the start of that referendum campaign, 30% of people were in favour of it, 70% of people were against it. By the end of that campaign, those figures were reversed. And as somebody said quite rightly earlier, we need to have the explanation of this up front. And unfortunately, at the moment, the media are not covering it, and what media does tends to be anti the euro. There is a good case to be made. I believe it is in the interest of this country. I do believe it can be won, and I would like us to get on building up that support as quickly as possible, and then to have the referendum.
Do you agree? Gerald Kaufman, do you agree it could be won if Tony Blair set his mind to it?
I'm sure it can be won, and I'm sure it will be won, because when the convergence principles are right, that's something we've got to do. There are convergence principles that the government have laid down about the economic criteria being right for us to go in. And that's what it will be judged like. The Tory party, insofar as it's got a consistent opinion, is simply stating it in slogan terms, though some of their slogans are pretty odd, David. I've got a quote here from Mr. Haig in 1997 saying, "I'm against the single currency in principle." And I've got a more recent quote from Mr. Haig saying, "I don't think it's necessary to say that we're against it in principle." So that's a bit confusing. What we have got to have is a national debate on this issue. And the case for and against has got to be put before the electorate with great clarity. That's what I want.
But you don't want it yet?
I believe that we've got to get the convergence principles right.
You have to wait till you can win, in other words, yes.
Oh, well, my dear David, don't you think that's a good idea?
No idea, it's up to you.
Gerald, I really don't think it's just about economics, and I think it's that kind of debate and the kind of way politicians are structuring the debate that leads to this kind of disillusionment with politics. There's a lot of complex arguments here, but the idea that you sit and wait until you think you can hit the bullseye because you go in at the right time, at the right level, in the right economic interest. I mean, if you ask young people in Germany and France why they're committed to the European agenda, they have ideals, they have aspirations, they talk about better futures. Now, I have personal views on this. My organisation very much stays out of the debate, I have to say. But I just think the nature of the debate is so wrong in terms of engaging with real political issues.
But you wouldn't wait for the time to be right then?
No, I think we should be just having a debate now. And I don't think it is an issue about the time being right.
I want to hear a bit more from members of our audience. The woman with her hand up in the air in black there, yes, you.
It's not the point that that Tony Blair and the Labour government are leading our country towards the euro without this debate. Only recently I read that the chairman of the tax harmonisation in Europe is led by a Briton, and we haven't even signed up yet. So is it not that Tony Blair and the Labour government are not going to allow us this debate?
But you've got your referendum. Does that not satisfy you, the promise of a referendum?
Well, it's not clear, is it? We don't know when and in what way and under what terms. We don't know any of this because it's not clear.
I'll take one more point. The man in the beard there. Sorry. Not the man with the moustache, but the man with the beard.
If it is up to the British people to decide whether we join the euro or not, why did last week did we sell half of our gold reserves without telling anybody?
You're a treasury man. Why did we sell our gold reserves? You're a treasury man.
As well.
I'm afraid I haven't got the answer. I don't work for the government anymore. But was I working for the government? No doubt I'd say we've got all these billions of pounds of bullion lying in the Bank of England doing nothing. The price of gold's gone down massively. And the Bank of England have recommended to the government that they need to sell something off so they need to be in other countries. I mean, it's not really, I don't see that as a political issue.
Why was an announcement made before the gold was sold allow the gold to drop even further?
No, well, the reason they did that, as I understand it, because they wanted openness and transparency. Yeah. If they secretly started selling it off, then that would be unfair on people who are holding gold by actually saying we're going to sell this gold.
Gerald
Kaufman. We're told that we shouldn't wait until the time is right, but plunge in. The Conservative government, Margaret Thatcher as Prime Minister and John Major as Chancellor of the Exchequer, took us into the European monetary system for party political reasons at a time which was absolutely wrong in terms of the exchange rate. As a result, it was a catastrophe and it led to billions lost from the exchanges. We need to do it. I'm in favour myself of going into the single currency at the right time. But to say that economic considerations ought not to be taken into account is living in cloud cuckoo land.
Very briefly, Theresa May.
The lady who said that what is the point of the referendum because of the way we're actually being taken towards the euro had in fact a good point, because that's one of the problems. What the government is doing is trying to get to a position where people think it's inevitable to go into the single currency. I don't think that's right. I think the British people should have a choice as to whether they go into a single currency, and the government should not be leading us down this path towards inevitability. The British people should be given that clear choice and have their say.
We'll go on to another question. Just before we do, Charlie Whelan, you mentioned that you used to spin for the Treasury. There was a
I didn't say that.
You did.
I used to work at the Treasury.
Oh, yeah, you used to work at the Treasury, yes. This is how I put it. But there was a lot of talk that Peter Mandelson should come back now to take control of Labour's policy for the next election. They'll lose it with Margaret Beckett. I mean, as a fellow spinster, do you think that'd be a good idea?
Peter Mandelson's not a great chum of mine, but I would say he is a brilliant tactician when it comes to running elections. And I think that Tony Blair wants Peter Mandelson to come back to work at Milbank. He certainly did a good backroom job in the last general election, and I think Peter should go back to work at Milbank. I mean, it'd be a waste of his talent if we just left him on the back benches.
Good. Okay. Endorsement there. A question now from Diane Fontaine, who's an English and history student. Diane.
The government's plans to place teenage mothers in hostel accommodation do anything to solve the problem of teenage pregnancies?
This was the proposal Tessa Giles said, that in a few years' time, teenage mothers under 18 wouldn't be allowed to go into single council house accommodation but go into hostels. Theresa May, do you approve of that?
I think that for some teenage mothers, they may very well need the support that can be provided in that sort of environment. And this was only, as I understand it, for teenage mothers who were not living at home within with their family and therefore getting the support from their family, rather than just putting them out into a council flat on their own.
They'd be refused council flats is the policy. They'll be refused them.
I think the issue that the lady, that the questioner raised about whether or not this would actually lead to a reduction in teenage pregnancies, I think that actually the issue, this is about those helping those who have actually become pregnant and have had their children. The issue about how you reduce the number of teenage pregnancies that we have in this country, which we all know is extremely high, certainly comparatively high, looking at other countries, I think is a complex one. A lot is talked, obviously, about sex education in schools. Well, we have had sex education in certainly in secondary schools for a number of years now. And I think there are a number of issues that actually have to be addressed. I think that one of the issues for young girls actually is not just educating them about sex, but actually giving them the self-confidence and the self-respect to be able to say no.
Do you think it was put forward as a policy to prevent them having getting pregnant? Is that the idea behind it? Do you think it was punitive, saying you won't get a council house, you will go into a hostel?
Yeah, I do, pretty much.
You think that was what was behind it?
Yeah. I think it's just, there's deeper issues to address, as you say. And I think that instead of concentrating on girls, that we need to look at boys, because it's teenage boys that coerce teenage girls into...
Gerald Kaufman.
Young women, very young women who have babies and who are not getting support from their families need support. It's a very difficult life. I see it in my constituency. It's a very difficult life to be a young woman on her own trying to bring up a baby. Quite often, it has to be said, on very low benefits, unable to go out to work, which is what she ought to be enabled to do, so that she makes a contribution and doesn't feel that society is oppressing her. I believe very strongly that young women who are on their own need support in bringing up a baby, and being given that assistance is very important. I also believe that while obviously all of these choices are free and should be free, nevertheless, a young woman ought to be able to take into account the consequences of having a baby on her own, in order that she should have the best circumstances for bringing the baby up. This is not a question of imposing some kind of public morality on individuals. I'm strongly against that. What I am in favour of is people being able to live their lives without their lives being a burden to them. Sentence, David. And far too often today, very young women with babies, they love their babies, but nevertheless, life is very difficult indeed for them.
But you say you want maximum freedom of choice and people taking responsibility for their own lives. To pass a law saying they may not go into single council accommodation surely is infringing that freedom, that right that every other person has.
I certainly would not believe that local authorities should be prevented in appropriate circumstances from allowing young women to have homes of their own. I would not support that. What I do believe is that those young women should be counselled, given advice and given help. And it may well be that they'll get that best help in residential accommodation rather than living on their own.
But you're against the policy?
I am against any policy in which local authorities will be told by the government what tenancies to allocate. I spent 18 years opposing that. I'm not going to change my mind now.
And that appears to be what Tessa Giles is considering. Don Foster.
Well, it's a funny old world, isn't it? Because when they were in government, the Tory party actually proposed something almost identical to this, and now we're here from Theresa May that she's uncertain about it. And when the Tory party proposed it, the Labour party, when in opposition, violently opposed it, and now they're proposing it.
Except for Gerald Kaufman.
Except, and I'm frankly delighted about Gerald, because I think what he's done is he's put forward a very sensible answer to the question. What he's saying is you look at the individual case and you try and provide the support that's necessary for that individual young mother and her baby. And incidentally, I was delighted by the comments about we must make sure this is not just talking about the girls, it's also talking about the boys, and I entirely agree with it. Can I just say, though, that if you look at the statistics, our figures are worse than in any other European country. That's worrying enough. But what is very significant is the other statistics which show that you are 10 times more likely to have a child as a young girl if you come from a very poor family than if you come from a very wealthy family. And so it's absolutely right to say that this is a much wider issue than just sexual promiscuity. We have got to look at some of those social issues. We've got to provide the support. And two other measures I would love to see the government take, which may not make me popular for saying it, but I believe it. It's very important. We have got to provide much more easier access to family planning for sexually active young people, and we should even go further and make it easier for some of them, if necessary, to get emergency contraception. That will help break the cycle.
With the highest teenage pregnancy rate in Europe, I'm not sure where we'd be as a country if we were buying huge numbers of these individuals their own house. Secondly, Mr. Kaufman talked about the counselling advice and support after the event. Surely that should be directed before the event.
Okay, and the woman in the second row from the back over there.
There is lack of information in schools to children. Children should be taught the consequences of all their actions. It's no good just teaching them how to have sex. You're supposed to be able to teach them in schools because it's not always done in the home, on what could happen and how they would have to live with it, whether they're a woman or whether they're
but,
a male.
But to be fair, the government are saying that they're...
The man in the green shirt there.
About lack of consequences. We all know the consequences. Everybody knows. They're not stupid, but they just choose not to. They just think, oh, okay, we'll think about it later. They all get, you know, if you go into colleges or schools, everybody gets told the consequences. You all have lessons, and it all just goes through them, but nobody cares. It's just the whole teenage thing. Just nobody cares there.
And what do you think of this this policy?
It's a good policy in theory. In practice, whether it will work or not, it's completely different, and whether the Labour government will actually go through with it or not is... depends if they're going to win any votes, doesn't it? Because that's what all the policies are based on.
Sheila McKechnie.
One of the great myths in housing, and this is from my past life, is that young women get pregnant to jump the housing queue. There's a very simple way...
I should say Sheila McKechnie ran shelter for a decade or more.
There's a very simple way to actually establish whether this is true or not, and that is to go and ask them what they think their rights are, and most of them don't know. They don't do it for that kind of reason. They do it for out of ignorance, stupidity, lack of self-respect, lack of a future, wanting to be loved in a society where they feel as if they've got very little. It's to do with that essence of respect. If you think you've got a future and a career, you by and large do not get pregnant when you're 16 or 17. The idea of hostels as a punishment, by the way, I think is complete nonsense. I mean, if the offer is the 14th storey of a high-rise flat with virtually no furniture and no one around you, and a rather nice hostel, because we're not going to be putting them into barracks like Cathy Come Home.
How do you know that?
Most young... because the housing associations and the local authorities of this country wouldn't do that.
So the supervised...
Mr. Blair ordered it, I think.
Right, okay.
It's not a punishment. And I think, let's... Look, some young women actually deal with this very successfully. And if they do want to have the child, and they want to carry on with their education, and they want to bring up that child, it isn't necessarily going to be a disaster. But they are going to need help, and I think the policy is perfectly sensible.
Okay. Charlie Whelan.
Well, I'm glad you raised the position about the boys, because I heard some idea about how a boy would lose his driving licence if he got someone pregnant. I mean, that seems to be wholly ridiculous. But I think more important, more important than that, I think, is that they say, the government say we're going to educate young people, and then the Department of Education say, or someone at the Department of Education says, that we're going to allow school nurses to issue condoms over my dead body. Now, really, that is totally ridiculous. On the one hand, you're trying to educate people. On the other hand, you're saying we're not going to allow them to have contraception. And I think that the government really needs to be doing more in that area.
Okay. I think we'll go on. Just before I take another question, if you'd like to take part in question time, next week we're going to be in Leeds. And there are places in our audience there if you want to come and argue the toss. In Birmingham the week after, that's on July the 1st, we've got the first of two special programmes, and it's a chance to quiz William Hague, who'll be here on his own. And a week after that, on July the 8th in London, a chance to cross-question the Prime Minister, Tony Blair. So those are two special programmes towards the end of the season. If you'd like to take part in those programmes, this is the number to ring, 0894... 114411, or get through to us on our website. Now let's go on. I take a question now from Mike Shorter, who's a recruitment agency manager. Mike Shorter.
We've all seen pictures recently of Serb forces returning home with their heavy weaponry intact.
Do members of the panel feel that they've been treated too leniently by NATO?
You think NATO should have disarmed them, or NATO wasn't successful during its war in destroying them?
No, I feel that NATO should have disarmed
Charlie
them.
Charlie Whelan, what do you think of that?
Well, I think that we managed to get a peace agreement with the Serbs, which actually avoided, I mean, if you, what you're talking about, if we're going to try and force them to give up all their weapons, you're talking about 50,000 armed men, and you've all seen on television the numbers and all the tanks that were there. I mean, to actually have a fight with them would have been catastrophic. I mean, we've already seen today and on the television today all the people that have been murdered and raped, and just imagine how much worse it would have been. I think it was right to have this peace agreement, and it has saved many, many more lives. And no, I don't agree with you. I don't think that would have been a good idea.
Gerald Kaufman.
Of course, if it were possible, it would be desirable. But the whole point about what has been taking place during these months in Kosovo is to do what was possible in order to stop the ethnic cleansing. That's why we did the bombing, which a lot of people disagreed with, but which I thought was unavoidable and there was no alternative to it. That's why when Milosevic finally, after twisting and turning, accepted the NATO terms, those NATO terms had to be carried out in the form in which they were agreed, both by NATO and by the Serbs. That being so, we have got to observe our side of it. And that did not include disarming these men. I was ready to contemplate, it's easy for me to say this, I was ready to contemplate young men from my constituency who served in the armed forces being killed to enforce NATO policy. I'm not prepared to see young men in my constituency being killed to go beyond NATO policy. So what I say is, what you put forward is eminently desirable and attractive, but not feasible.
The man in the second row.
I think the Russians should have been brought into this whole conflict much earlier and much more closely in cooperation with NATO, because I think what we're seeing now is that as NATO occupy Kosovo, that we're facing another humanitarian crisis with the Kosovo Serbs running away north. Perhaps they feel safer with the Russians.
What do you think of the Russian move into the airport at Pristina?
I think it's expressing their frustration and impatience with NATO's unilateral action.
The man at the very back there, do you agree with that?
Well, I just wanted to say I don't think it's practical to have disarmed the Serbs, but there's been clearly some very evil atrocities committed, and there's some war criminals. Those are the people that should be pursued, and they should be pursued without any statute of limitation, in my opinion.
Theresa May.
I think, first of all, we ought actually to acknowledge that an awful lot has been achieved in Kosovo and to congratulate our armed forces on what they have achieved and on what they are achieving as we speak at this moment. And I think it's important to look to the future and to ensure, because there are enormous difficulties still there in terms of implementing the peace deal that has actually been agreed. And in these matters, there's always an element of having to look at pragmatism and practicalities. There are still difficulties to be overcome, but we must look to the future and to trying to achieve what has been the overall objective of this conflict, which is actually ensuring that the Kosovo refugees can return home. And I think that we have to focus on that at the moment.
The man in the second row here.
The question was were they right to not disarm the Yugoslavians or the Bosnians? Well, what my opinion is as regards that is, if you disarm them, you leave them wide open for Albania to have a go. And as Mr. Kaufman said, he should remember, as well as I do, sitting in air raid shelters with bombs dropping down. I don't think the bombing of Yugoslavia was the answer. The answer was to have cut the country off completely. And then, within a very short period, they would have had to come to terms.
Okay.
No
McKechnie.
Trade either way.
Sheila McKechnie.
I think I disagree with the question, going back completely, because, you know, the quality of any civilization is how you deal with people that you have defeated. And it's a measure of the kind of Europe that we're going to want in the future, that we behave to standards that we would like everybody else to. I think we're on a powder keg. I don't actually agree with withholding economic support to rebuilding Serbia. I don't. I think there are many ways in which that can be done without reinforcing Milosevic. And I think if we actually carry on and make the kind of Serbs the pariahs of the world, then I actually think the chances of long-term stability, which is what we're going to have, what we want in that area, is going to be much more difficult to achieve. I wish the whole thing hadn't happened either. I wish the kind of money that has gone into pursuing the war had went into building an economic...
Well, sorry, you think that if we put money into the Balkans, you could have avoided what we've seen on the screens has been happening in Kosovo?
Yes, and I actually think the much bigger problem is what we in the West have done vis-a-vis Russia. Because the way we actually encouraged Russia to liberalise its economy, and the people that roared in there with their dollars and whatever, and set up basically a whole team of gangsters to run the country, means that it didn't make a transition into stability that we wanted. And had we managed that differently, we wouldn't be in this situation now of being absolutely terrified what's going to happen in Russia.
The woman in the front row here, the woman in red in the front row.
So what happens to Milosevic now? He was indicted as a war criminal, but what's going to happen? It's impossible to go into Serbia and get him, so he's got away with murder.
And the man with the moustache there in the centre?
Whilst we detest all the crimes that have taken place in Albania, we must not run the risk of demonising the Serbian population. They themselves are a people who've suffered. Many were driven out of Krajina 5 years ago by the Croats. So we must take great care not to demonise the Serbian population.
We missed our chance in 1995 at Dayton as well. They could have sorted out the Kosovo situation then, but they wouldn't let the Albanians into the talks. And as far on top of that, the KLA refusing to disarm, so they're now committing some atrocities against the Serbians, which is leading the Serbians to leave Kosovo.
Let's go back to the question, Don Foster, which was whether it's right for NATO to allow the Serbs through without making any attempt to disarm them.
I think that was the right decision. I'm very conscious of the fact that if we're going to ultimately get stability in the region, it will come not from a military solution, but from a diplomatic solution. And that diplomatic solution is what I think we're now being able to build up. Two other points very briefly, David, if I may. Firstly, one of the things I hope we will now do is to provide much more support to the war crimes tribunal people who are going in to Kosovo to get the sort of evidence that is going to be necessary for carrying out the sorts of trials that I hope subsequently will happen. But no, but what we can do, and it comes on to the other point I wanted to make, I don't agree with Sheila McKechnie when she says that we should be giving the money for the rebuilding of Serbia. What I think we should definitely be doing, and perhaps we partially agree, is we must be giving humanitarian aid to the people in Serbia for the very reason the gentleman said, that it wasn't the people of Serbia we're opposed to, but we should not be providing the restructuring money at the present time until they have got rid of Milosevic, which brings
well,
us back
I'm
to your
not
point.
I'm not suggesting, Don, that we give it to them to repair their tanks, for God's sake. You know, I mean, I think this issue of victimisation is one that is just going to compound the problems in this area.
Sheila, I think the government are just saying that now. They obviously can't say we'll give them aid, but I'm sure once it's all over, they will give aid.
Sure.
But you think they will give aid regardless?
Yeah, I think they will.
But why do they have to say that now?
Because precisely the reason that other people are saying, that to give money to Milosevic seems ridiculous. But if you look at the whole of the Balkan region, to say you're not going to give aid to the Serbs, which is the most important part of the whole Balkan region, it would be like saying we're going to give no aid to London or no aid if the rest of the country was falling apart.
Okay. And take one point from the man at the back there in the white shirt.
The good thing about this particular alliance is the fact that for the first time, unlike Iraq and unlike Libya, we've come in on the side of a Muslim population and country.
Okay. Right, well now look, we've got a quarter of an hour left for the programme and I want to try and fit two more questions in. So I'm going to move on fairly swiftly and take a question from Stacey Yeomans, who's a trainee accountant. Stacey Yeomans.
Can the panel
Can the panel offer a plausible explanation why the ban of cigarette advertising will reduce young smokers, but then it's allowed in Formula One racing and snooker? Will that not, you know, promote cigarettes?
The government is accelerating the banning. December this year, there'll be no billboards, no newspaper and cigarette promotions, but snooker and Formula One are excluded. Sheila McKechnie.
Well, banning advertising has been shown to work in other countries. It does have an impact. There is evidence, researched evidence, so what the companies say about it just being about switching brands is not actually true.
But there the question swiftly is, well, why is it okay then to advertise on Formula One and on snooker?
Well, of course it isn't. It isn't acceptable. I don't support that. I think it should have been across the board. I think you're quite right on that point. There's hypocrisy in it. But it was the deal that was done in Europe. I very much regret what our Prime Minister did in respect of that. I think it created a great problem in the Department of Health and getting the message out straight. So I would like it to stop, full stop, as soon as possible.
Gerald Kaufman.
I voted for bills to ban tobacco advertising for years during the Conservative government when they were blocked by the Conservative whips. And that being so, I am very strongly indeed in favour of a ban on tobacco advertising. I am in favour, in principle certainly, of an overall and total ban, including Formula One and snooker. There are certain problems with regard to people who are getting money from tobacco advertising. I got a letter from a symphony orchestra in Northern Ireland asking if I would not support a ban on tobacco advertising because they were subsidised by tobacco. It may not always be possible to do everything on the same date, though I would like it to be done on the same date, and I would like Formula One and snooker to be involved in this ban that ends in December. So I am, on the other hand, satisfied that at any rate it's going to happen.
But I mean, as chairman of the committee that looks at the sport, media and the arts, you don't want to see tobacco anywhere in there.
When we had cricketers in front of us, cricketers subsidised by Benson and Hedges, I said, how can you reconcile the projection of a sport that dwells upon the cleanliness of activity with this filthy pollution of people who use it? And I do not believe that you can have all kinds of arguments. You can say that kids should work down pits if the circumstances prevail. You've got to take a view on principle. My view is that smoking is bad, it kills, it makes people suffer. If you're looking at the economic side of it, it costs the nation billions of pounds more that we could on the National Health Service and in other ways. I believe it should be banned, and I'm quite clear about it.
So hypocritical. You take the revenue, you ban advertising, the kids are still smoking, they're not interested in adverts, they want the cigarettes, while you sit there and take the revenue.
Well, do you believe then, because if you do, I'd be interested to hear it, do you believe that there should be a ban on the manufacture of cigarettes in this country?
Yes, I do, and I'm a smoker.
Do you...
What I'd say to you
is, physician, heal yourself, and while you take that attitude, don't accuse me of hypocrisy.
I admit to being a hypocrite. I admit it, you don't.
Would you like to see smoking banned?
Would you like
to see smoking made illegal? Like,
if somebody wants to smoke and it's their option, put them away in a corner. I'm quite happy to go in a corner and have a cigarette so as not to offend my fellow man. But overall, I would like to see it, if either treat us for nicotine addiction like you treat a heroin addict or anybody else that's addicted to a drug, or shut up, get down off your high horse and do something about it and stop taking
the
money.
We're doing something.
Theresa May. Theresa May.
Yes. I can't stop sugar growth and I'm 6'4".
Theresa May.
Yes. We want to see effective ways of persuading young people either to stop smoking or not to start smoking in the first place, because it is bad for people's health. I'm not convinced that just banning advertising is actually the most effective way to
do that.
Are you in
favour of it?
Can I just finish this? I'm not convinced that banning advertising is the most effective way of doing it. There is actually a more complex set of issues around the whole question, I think, of why young people actually take up smoking. And in fact, today we've actually launched a working group to look at that set of issues.
That'll settle
everything. To look at.
No, but are you?
Well, the Labour Party ought to know about that, given the amount of reviews and working parties they've set up. But the serious point about it is, Gerald, that what is happening from the government is the government is going for the headline of saying they're banning advertising, and they're not actually looking at behind what is actually leading to young people smoking and how you can have more effective ways of stopping
them. I'm sorry, but I must press you on this. Do you want or don't you want a ban on advertising?
I am not convinced that a ban on tobacco advertising is going to have the effect that the government says it is going to do. But we all know why the government's got themselves into this position of saying they're going to ban advertising except for Formula One and snooker. I seem to remember the name of a certain Mr. Bernie Eccleston, who gave the Labour Party £1 million. Oh, I'm sorry,
What about
he gave it back afterwards, after it was
proven. What about this chap who was your treasurer and is Belize ambassador to the United Nations? How much does he give you?
Well, what does... But he's...
not as much
are you comparing like and like?
What I'm saying is that the pot shouldn't call a very clean vessel black.
Charlie Whelan.
Well, of course, what Theresa doesn't say is that the tobacco companies have been bankrolling the Tory party for many years now. Now, I'm afraid I'm one of those people who's been trying to give up smoking for about the last 20 years, and on and off I have managed sometimes, I haven't. But the reason for that, of course, is it's an addictive drug, and it's also a dangerous drug, and of course it's right to ban tobacco advertising. And, well, I'm not too bothered about snooker, I hate snooker anyway, but Formula One, well, it is a world event, I suppose we'll let them off for a few years, but I support the government on this one.
See what Gordon Brown lost.
Don Foster, briefly, because I want to get to one last and serious question.
I don't think it matters whether or not the banning of advertising is the most effective way of reducing people's smoking. We know that it works and will reduce it, and therefore what the government is doing is absolutely right. We also know that if you increase the price, that will reduce it, and therefore it's right to continue to put the price up. And thirdly, we know...
But the black market.
I can tell you the evidence is very clear that it does reduce the number of people smoking, the number of people who start, and thirdly, we can do something about education. The Bernie Eccleston saga does leave a bad taste in the mouth, and I have to confess, I do not understand the argument that says snooker and Formula One, which are very popular sports, which I'd have thought would have little difficulty getting additional sponsorship, are given this leeway, whereas something like fishing, which has real difficulty getting the money in, doesn't get it. It's nonsense, so ban the lot straight away.
Okay, right. Thank you very much. Now, this last question, we'll have to go fairly smartly through it, but it's a very important one. William Wilson, who is a stores officer.
What will Tony Blair do next if the Northern Ireland issue is not settled by the June the 30th deadline?
He said in the House of Commons that June the 30th was the last chance for peace in Northern Ireland. If it's not settled, what does he do next? Gerald Kaufman.
I don't see how the newly elected assembly can function if we don't get a settlement by the 30th. I was in Northern Ireland last week and I was talking to David Trimble, a man whom I admire immensely and who has risked a very, very great deal for peace. I think that Northern Ireland deserves an opportunity for peace, and that's why Tony is trying to find a formula whereby the Northern Ireland Assembly can function. I think it will be a terrible setback if Tony Blair's deadline isn't met.
So the answer is there's nothing that he can do if June the 30th doesn't work. I mean, there is no other
plan.
Well,
no, he won't give up, he won't stop, he'll have to try different ways. But what we're talking about is the implementation of the Good Friday Agreement, which is an act of enormous courage by David Trimble, is an act of huge commitment by the Social Democratic and Labour Party in Northern Ireland, and in which Sinn Féin were persuaded to take part as well. And one of the things we've got to be very, very clear about is that while we have to protect the position of David Trimble, we cannot afford to lose Sinn Féin from this whole process.
Do you think that the suggestion that he made in his speech, that Sinn Féin might say we want decommissioning but the IRA won't give it and we oppose them for not doing that, is a realistic proposition to put?
I don't think that Tony is going to talk for the idle sake of talk. He's invested a very, very great deal of his time and effort in this process. In the end, I believe that it's David Trimble who will have to make the decision. It's an extraordinarily difficult decision. I don't envy him, but he's a man of great courage.
Don Foster?
I don't want to add very much to what Gerald's just said. I mean, I think there's a number of people who deserve great praise for what they've done. One person Gerald didn't mention, I'm sure would join me in saying, has done an enormous lot, is Mo Molam. I think she's been absolutely fantastic.
But do you see the 30th of June, the date the Prime Minister set, as a real deadline after which...
The reality is that what you do in any diplomacy is you rightly set deadlines at which you desperately try to get everybody to work to bring the solution by that particular deadline. But this is too important to ultimately have to say that if that deadline comes and we haven't succeeded, that therefore we give up and go away. But diplomacy obviously requires you to set tight deadlines and try and get people to solve it by then. But I don't believe that even if it's not solved by the 30th, that means the end of it. Mo Molam, all those other people are not going to give up.
OK, the man in the white T-shirt there.
So why haven't we got a deadline for a referendum on the euro?
If that's so... All right.
Charlie Williams. I've made it very clear I'd like to see that deadline as soon as possible.
Charlie Williams. I think there simply has to be an agreement on Northern Ireland. I don't think there's any turning back. We have to implement the Good Friday Agreement. I just do wish, you know, I'd say to some of your colleagues, Theresa, that they were a bit more supportive of the Northern Ireland Agreement, because I think everybody needs to come together to support it.
We have consistently supported the Good Friday Agreement. What we want to see is the full implementation of the Good Friday Agreement. And we have what the points that we have raised as a very valid point, that we now have released onto the streets 270 terrorist prisoners released early, but the paramilitaries have not yet decommissioned not a single arm, not a single gun, not a single ounce of Centex. And Gerald Kaufman said at the end of his comments, and I entirely agree with the comments that he made about the courage of David Trimble in taking this matter as far as he has done. He indicated at the end that the decision was that of David Trimble. I sincerely hope that it is not going to be the case, that the government sees that pushing David Trimble is simply the way to resolve this. But I think it's time the finger was pointed at the paramilitaries who have refused to decommission.
But the Prime Minister said... The Prime Minister says that under the Good Friday Agreement, decommissioning isn't a precondition for the setting up of the executive. Do you accept that?
At the time of the Good Friday Agreement, the Prime Minister made clear within the separate letter, as I understand it, that was given to David Trimble, and indeed within the campaign for the referendum, that decommissioning was an element, and I think it's important that decommission be seen as an element.
William Wilson, just very briefly, from what you've heard, what's your view?
Unfortunately, I don't think there will be an agreement by June the 30th, and I think what Mr. Blair is going to do is going to put it back for another same month, the end of July. I don't think it will be an agreement.
It's interesting, isn't it? It's a very fine balancing act, and we've seen before in Northern Ireland that if a deadline is set and the big guns pile in and everybody has to concentrate, then things do move. But it's always a bit risky, because if you then don't reach an agreement, the stakes become very high. And I have to say, I think the politicians who are dealing with the situation are almost universally to be respected, because they're dealing with some very entrenched issues, they're dealing with it with great care, and for God's sake, just keep them talking, because the ordinary people can kind of get on with their life.
Okay, well, we're over our deadline, so thank you very much indeed to all of you here in the audience in Manchester, to all of you on the panel. Next week, we are going to be in Leeds, as I said, and our panel there will include the Social Security Secretary, Alistair Darling, Nicholas Soames, the Conservative MP, and the leader of the Socialist Labour Party, Arthur Scargill. Yep. So I hope you'll join us again next Thursday. Until then, good night.
More topical discussion on BBC Two now, including a debate on the latest developments in Kosovo. That's Dispatch Box.